Our first two co-presenters are Viviana Fazzullo, a first-year PhD student at Florida Atlantic University. Her areas of concentration are French and Italian literature. She earned both her bachelor's degree in modern arts and her master's degree in philology from the University of Naples in Italy. In 2015, she taught Italian language and culture at the University of Krakow in Poland, and she now teaches French as a graduate teaching assistant at FAU. Federico Tiberini graduated at the University of Pescara, where he earned a BA in translating and interpreting, and an MA in foreign languages for business. He also spent two semesters at University of Alabama in Birmingham, thanks to the study abroad program. He is currently enrolled in his second MA in comparative literature at Florida Atlantic University. He is a graduate teaching assistant in Italian languages and cultures at FAU. I also have another author of the paper who wasn't able to be here today, Vincenza Yadavaya. And they will be presenting their paper, Orality and Microhistory, Italian Americans in Florida.
First of all, thank you very much for having us here. We are very happy to be here at the Calandra Institute to present our project. And so the project we would like to present today is in cooperation with our friend and colleague, Vincenza Yadavaya, who cannot be here today as Melissa told. And this is a project that we started around 6 months ago. Our intent is to start an oral history archive of Italian Americans in South Florida. This culturally rich group has not been studied yet in this specific area. In fact, the only study on Italian migration is Getty Morminos, but only in the area of Tampa. And this is the only study on Italian migration in the state of Florida. So we would like to add something to this research. Morbino, according to Morbino, Tampa was the only place where a primary wave of immigrants arrived and found employment in the cigar factories. His historical research concerned the years from 1885 till 1985, so overlooking the past few decades. So we would like to extend this research to South Florida up to now. Quite recently, a large number of people started to inhabit South Florida, especially after the mass spread of air conditioning, as you can imagine. We would like to create a work in progress database, which will be available also for future studies. Our goal is to collect memories and first impressions of people who choose Florida as their new land. It is a concept that we want to explore. In fact, the majority of them have settled here, better there, in a second move, usually leaving their first place of arrival of their parents or grandparents. The study proceeds by asking a set of questions to selected Italian Americans while recording their voices. For us, it's very important to record their voices because we want to keep memory of these stories. We want to save these stories for future generations. And all these questions are all related to three main themes: the migration to Florida, so the concept of place and space, the importance of objects, and the value of orality. All the interviewees are Italian Americans of first, second, and in some interesting cases, third generations, who moved to South Florida at different stages of their life.
Our first exploration will be a definition of South Florida as an Italian place, based on Tim Craswell's concept, and I'm quoting. Sense of place refers to the more nebulous meanings associated with a place, the feelings and emotions a place evokes. So our question are, why did Italian Americans choose Florida as their new home? Could this state of the sun also be a state of the mind? If people give meaning to a place, which meaning did Italian Americans give to this new land? As Craswell says, and I'm quoting again, in any given place, we encounter a combination of materiality, meaning, and practice. So, our research questions imagine that Italian American places in South Florida can be considered reflections of their imagined space. In fact, according to our research, Florida experienced a migration of people attracted here, or as I say better, there, by the tropical environment and the weather that remind them of Paesaro Sol, the land of the sun. On the other hand, there are also people who arrived in South Florida only because of their job and who admitted that before moving there, they were alibis at first because influenced by this idea of fake paradise or a barren land. A very effective example to express the difference between Florida and the rest of the United States is the way they live and conceive the space of the house. houses for Italian immigrants represented and still represent a pivotal element in their lives. We have, for example, the story of Anne Capone, the aunt of the poetess Giovanna Capone. Anne was born in the New York area in 1932, and her parents moved from Afragola, a small town close to Naples, Italy. They immigrated and settled in New York around 1915. Anne's parents spent their whole life there. Instead, Anne moved to South Florida during the 50s. Her parents went to visit her in 1957. And this is a picture of them with her cousin. And you can see Florida, July 1957. Her parents were amazed by the beauty of Florida, so Anne asked her father to move to Florida. And we can hear his answer.
When he looked outside, all the sunshine, he didn't like the winter because he always got sick. So he saw the nice sunshine and he said, you live in paradise. Oh, I said, well, if you like Florida this much, why don't you come and live here? He says, there's no cellars. Where am I going to store my wine? Now, that was a big problem.
As you can see, her parents were very amazed, but there was a big problem. So Anne's father used to produce wine and then store his bottle in the cellar. So the only reason he didn't want to move to Florida was because he didn't have the houses didn't have cellars there. In fact, in places like Florida, Alabama, Louisiana, and Eastern Texas, houses cannot have basements and cellars because of the nature of the soil. In fact, these territories are characterized by the presence of swampland, wetland, and coastline. And so, the great amount of the water in soil makes it possible to build basement without running into flooding, mold, or rot. When the water table is less than a meter under the ground, as it is in South Florida, the requisite 8 or more feet of depth for a basement is impossible. So, Anne's father refused to move closer to his daughter and live in a heaven on earth like Florida. As we have seen, not only Florida homes are different because of the structure, but also because of the value they convey. As Robert Viscusi states, and I'm quoting, Italian America is most frequently, most easily to be found in Italian houses in America. Most of the time, the houses of the Italian Americans in Florida are quite new. They didn't inherit them from their parents. So this is why it is so important for them to fill their dwellings with objects from their past, attributing an old soul to a new place. Using Viscusi's categories, Italian Americans' houses could be classified as shrines, villas, palazzos, and embassies. And we would like also to add a new category for this list for Italian American houses in Florida, the museum. As a shrine, the houses becomes also the place of worship per excellence. While in Long Island, for example, religious processions are performed in the streets by the entire community, as Dr. Shora knows very well, in Florida, faith becomes an intimate moment to share only with the members of the family within the delimited space of the house. Many of our interviewees, for example, keep in their houses sacred images of saints or nativities. The nativity, in particular, goes back to an ancient Italian tradition of handicraft. This is just a small part of Vincent's collection. We place this picture next to a stanza of Joseph Tuziani's Song of Bicentennial. We like the idea of making images interact with pieces of literature in order to emphasize reciprocally their inner meanings. The poem fosters this idea of handicraft, consisting on the different components of which the nativity is made up. Religion is also a key element in the Italian-American life, and it recurred many times during our interviews. We noticed that almost every interviewee, especially the elder people, mentioned his or her own devotion to religion, the Madonna, and to a specific saint. In particular, the most devoted were San Gennaro and Sant'Antonio di Padova. Holy cards or objects related to religion are always present in houses of Italians in Florida. These objects are a representation of worship and devotion. For example, one of our interviewees, Jean Gianrusso, told us that her family was very devoted to Saint Ennio Padua, especially her grandmother.
When we went to Italy in 1972, we had to go to Padua because my grandmother was devoted to Sant'Antonia di Padua. I think my mother chose her husband because his name was Antonio. I really believe that. But anyway, and she had a picture on the wall in her bedroom of St. Anthony of Padua.
The poem we choose is Letter to San Gennaro by Joseph Tuziano. It showed the importance of this saint for the believers. San Gennaro and Sant'Antonio are not only holy figures, but above all a reason to live. In Tuziani's poem, a new figure has been sanctified. We don't find only San Gennaro and Sant'Antonio, but also Christopher Columbus. He is described not as a conqueror, but rather as a savior, because he discovered a new land in which Italians can migrate and have a better life. For this reason, Christopher Columbus is elevated to a holy status and deserves to be prayed like a saint.
So, the presepe and the picture of the saints belong to this group of talking objects that we decided to discuss today. Another important item, which is not only present in every house we visited, but also exposed in plain view, is the wedding picture. Italian Americans have a deep devotion for their parents, and it's evident in this picture that we took at Anne's place, one of our interviews. As you can see, Anne conserved this photo exposed in her living room as relics. A glass, I don't know if you can see it, but a glass protects both the picture but also the frame, and as it was an inestimable treasure. Yeah. So, when Anne's mother, Rosa, arrived in the United States, she reunited with her half-sister and went where other paisanos were already settled. So she met a young man from her hometown, Afragola, called Domenico. He had moved to America 15 years earlier, and he was 13 years older than her, but Anne told that it was pretty common at those times. They got married in 1932. We decided to juxtapose a poem by Felix Stefanile, because it expresses this idea of materialized memory, which takes the shapes of a picture. One could also pay attention at the glare of the young couple, the two young lovers. They are only 17 and 32 years old, but they look adult, and they seem reflecting Stefanile's word when he says, life is work, and work is life, I will say. In addition to the wedding picture, another item that we found at Anne's place is a bedspread. The bedspread is an object extremely representative of Italian American history, which recurs many times in Italian American literature as well. Maybe the most important and the most famous example of bedspread that we can find in Italian American literature is the coperta that Umbertina loses in the eponymous novel by Ellen Barolini. The bedspread is the symbol of all the sacrifices she has made to support her family and to give her children a better life. In fact, at a certain point, she has to sell it, and even though at a later time she tries to get it back, it is impossible, and all her attempts are vain. When Umbertina is about to die, she sees her bedspread as a sort of vision or hallucination, then she dies. On the other hand, another example could be Mario Puzo's mother, Lucia Santa in The Fortunate Pilgrim, who suffers for being denied a bedspread when she got married, because her family could not afford it and they were too poor. So Anne bedspread was sued by Rosa, her mother, and she inherited it. And Rosa learned how to sew in the convent because she was an orphan. And she told us also the story of how orphans and little girls learn in the convent by the nuns how to sew or to embroider, because they had to embroider, for example, tablecloths or laces to sell to noble, rich families, in this case in Naples, but I think it's pretty common all over Italy. And one can also see the initials of Rosa Tremonti on the bottom of the picture. It's very, very beautiful. Another example is Jean Jarusso's bedspread, because she still has her grandmother's bedspread. And even though Jean is third generation migrant, we decided to include her in our study because she spent her entire childhood and adolescence with her grandmother, who was Italian, and who raised her and taught her dialect. Jean's example allows us to analyze another important element of Italian American thematic repertoire, the corredo. And
I guess marriage in the bedroom set was very important. My grandmother had the most beautiful mahogany bedroom set It's probably worth a lot of money today. So when I got married, my aunt, who was still living in my grandmother's house, decided that she would have that bedroom set refurbished, and she gave it to us as a wedding present. So I still sleep in my grandmother's bed as I did as a child. And it's funny because whenever my husband wants to, my husband is a person who teases a lot. You know, he's a big jokester. So when I get mad at him for something, he says, "Watch out, I'll sell that bedroom set." And I always say, "Over my dead body, I'll sell you before I sell the bedroom set."
As you heard, and as also John N. Cavallo says, the corredo is an object that connects different generations. In Jean's case, for example, she inherited the Italian bedspread previously belonging to her grandmother through her aunt, and it's a link for her matriarchal lineage. The corredo is described as a gift and is almost a necromantic element that bridges past and present. While Anne stores her bedspread in a plastic bed, she took it out, but trust us, she stores it in a plastic bed. Jean sleeps in it. So these are two completely different ways to give importance to an object. One is to preserve it, to consider it as a museum piece. The other is to make it live again through usage. Another object of interest that we found was Vincent's suitcase, and this one. And it's also its story is extremely moving. It's a meaningful memento for Vincent because it is the suitcase he used to migrate from Italy to the United States. Looking at the picture, we can easily notice the stamp on the suitcase, the first picture, that tells us the location and the date of the departure. He left his home country in 1962, and he told us during the interview what he brought with him inside the suitcase. And you can hear it from his words.
"And with me, I had one small suitcase. It wasn't really a suitcase, it was made of wood, which my uncle built for me, full of my notebooks and my books from first grade to eighth grade. And I still have them in my house. I still have my first grade when I was writing my little penmanship, the little story, and the little poem to my mother when I was a little boy in first grade."
So he had only a few clothes and books and notebooks from his classes. He attended elementary school in Italy, and he considered these notebooks a little treasure to keep safe and sound. As you can see in the second picture, we can see the notebooks inside the suitcase. And the third photo, we can see Vincent with his parents on the Saturnia, that is the ship that took him to United States. So, and also, yes, on this picture, the first picture is Vincent's class, when he was still in Italy. The second one is one of the notebooks that we found in his suitcase. And the other two photos are very interesting because the third one is a composition he wrote when he was in second grade. And it was, "Imagine yourself in 20 years. So, and he wrote something like, "I want to be a teacher." And actually he became a teacher, so pretty interesting. And the third one is, he wrote down a lullaby. So for us it was really like finding a time machine. It was incredible. So when one takes a look at this little treasure, it's like going back to his childhood. And so one can imagine little Vincent on his way to school holding his notebooks and pencils.
But sometimes people not only carry objects with them, but also precious memories that they store in their minds instead of their houses. Mottos, lullabies, idiomatic expression in Italian become a latent part of the vocabulary of Italian-Americans. Expressions like capatos, used by Anne, or bella figura, used by Daniel, recur while they're talking. It is very important to emphasize the importance of dialect, because our interviews choose it when they want to express a concept as much clear as they could. Dialect is a living language inside of them, and it becomes out when they want to show their Italianness, or we can call it Italianità. The two examples that we want to present are a lullaby and a nursery rhyme, both in Neapolitan dialect. We found the lyrics that you see on the screen, a collection of Canti del Popolo Napoletano, Chants of Neapolitan People, by Gian Battista Basile, who wanted to transcribe all these old songs in a written format. We're gonna hear, this is a lullaby sang by Ginger Russo.
"I was the oldest of the grandchildren. I saw a lot of the babies born after me. And of course, we took naps every afternoon because we were little. So I remember I don't remember my grandmother rocking me, but I saw her rock all the other children. I can still picture the crib in the bedroom, and she sang. Yamanusand, et chenevene due, chenevene la, maron sant'Antonio. Chiamene due, et chenevene tre, chenevene la, santa Giuseppe. And she'd go on and on and on and on, naming the saints and rocking the baby in the crib. And it was like a mantra, you know, it put everybody to sleep. And there were more saints in Italian than I could even imagine.
So when singing, her intonation changes and she also becomes emotional, as much as she was born and raised in Italy and not in the United States. Jean learned dialect from her grandmother. In fact, even if Jean speaks English as first language, when she speaks her dialect, one can hear an old inflection. She sings the lullaby in Neapolitan in the same way she learned it from her grandmother. Jean's memory of her grandmother lives in her accent, and her dialect is a proof of her existence. And then we have a nursery rhyme that Anne's father, Domenico, used to sing to her while rocking her on his knees.
Sega, Sega, Master Chief, Nava, Nava, Nusa, Oh, sausage and chow manchami, abanet and chastaba. I remember that.
So, we decided to conclude our presentation quoting a sentence that Anne, so our friend Anne, pronounced at the end of our interview. She was talking about her life and what she had been through and why she decided to move to Florida at a certain point of her life. So, when we asked her for a reason, this is the answer she gave us.
Well, it's il destino. I believe in that. Because from New York I came here. It was my destiny. We all have a destiny. Don't you agree?
And we agreed. Thank you very much.
This is very interesting. I would have 10 questions for you, but I limit
to... We can talk outside if you want.
I limit to one or two.
Okay.
I was wondering if it's always... a movement, this one to Florida is always a movement of retirement that people do, or if there is a direct stream that go to Italy there to, and if there is to do what kind of works they do there. And finally, if in your interview you focus your interest to the period in Florida, or if you also ask about their previous family experience in other part of the United States, and later I ask you more.
It's a very interesting question. Okay, yes, of course we ask a lot of questions about their family because it's the direct link to their Italianità, their Italianness. So they talk about their families and the way they used to live with their families when they were, for example, and used to live in the New York area. So she told us about her experience at that time. But we're also interested, as I said, in the second move. We don't want to call it a second migration, but a second move, because usually people do not go from Italy to Florida, but they do it in two steps. They migrated from Italy to, for example, the New York area, or they went to Pittsburgh or Chicago. They were, as you know, the cities where the majority of Italian Americans were settled, but not only there. They moved in the second move to Florida. And it's not, interestingly enough, it's not only for retirement. We thought it when we started our interviews, we thought, okay, all of them will say that they came here because of the sun, they wanted to spend their retirement in a nice place. But actually, for example, Anne, she moved when she was a young woman. She met her husband in Florida. That's why she said it's in destino, because she was talking about how she met his husband. She moved when she was around 18 years old, and she went there to find job. So basically the two main reasons we found when we asked for why they moved to Florida, one is for the weather, because most of them used to get sick when they were in colder weather. So they decided to move to a warmer place, so Florida. And all the second group, they moved because of the job. So in fact, some of them also were not very happy to go to a place that they described, as Federico say, as a barren land or a fake paradise. And we were impressed because we thought everybody wants to go to Florida, and apparently not. So it was surprising.
So you're specifically studying Italians. But there are other ethnic groups who've gone to Florida, and the one that, the largest one that comes to mind are the Jews. You know, and there are many, many parallels between the Jewish culture and the Italian culture, especially their love for family and their love for food. So has your research, have you found anything in your research to make those parallels between the Jewish culture and, you know, the Jewish migrants and the Italians?
Actually, yes. And it was our second interview, and our interview was, his name was David, yes. And he was Jewish also. And he told us about Miami. I don't actually, unfortunately, I don't remember the year when he moved to Florida, but he described this, exactly what you said, that in Miami there were a lot of Jewish...
During the 60s.
And there were a lot of Jewish people, and there were actually real neighborhoods where Jews used to live, and there were, I don't want to say ghetto, but it was very close neighborhoods. And he told us that he found a lot of similarities between these two, we can say ethnic group, even though it's not really ethnic. But it was pointed out by one of our interviews, so
it was going to be our next step.
Yes.